You're good to go.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee meeting for Monday, June 5th, 2023. We're going to go around the room and do introductions. This group hasn't met in a long time. We will have got a jam-packed agenda of things for you to go through, but we'll do a little bit of orientation before we get into all that. I'll go ahead and kick it off. Allison Osterberg, Senior Planner with Thurston Regional Planning Council, just here to support you today. And I also want to call out my colleague, Casey Mock, from Thurston Regional Planning Council, who is also providing support today. On the committee, I'll walk through our list of representatives that I think we have on the call, and just you can bring up your video and unmute for a minute and just say hello. Do we have anyone today from the town of Bucota? Not expecting anyone. How about from the city of Lacey?
Malcolm Miller, City of Lacey Deputy Mayor.
Welcome, Malcolm. And from the City of Olympia?
Clark Gilman, Mayor Pro Tem.
And from the City of Rainier?
Dennis McVeigh, Council Member.
And from the City of Tenino? And from the City of Tumwater?
Eileen Swarthout, Council Member.
And from the City of Yelm. I believe we will have a Yelm representative joining us a little bit later. And from Thurston County.
I'm Enter, Vice Chair of the Board of County Commissioners.
And also joining us, I think we have representatives from the Confederated Tribes of the Chehalis.
Yep. Amy Loudermilk, I'm the planning director for the tribe.
And from the Nisqually Indian Tribe.
Hello, David Isle, Nisqually Tribal Council.
Great. And so I think that's our subcommittee today. We also have a number of staff providing technical support who are in the meeting remotely. So let me kind of go down the list if you want to come out and say hello. We've got Caitlin Nelson from Thurston County.
Good afternoon.
Caitlin will be presenting today. We've got Ryan Andrews from the City of Lacey.
Everybody.
So we'll be presenting. Let's see who else I've got here. Grant Beck from the City of Lacey. And Jeremy Davis from Thurston County.
Good afternoon.
And I know I saw Mike Matlock from the City of Tumwater.
Good afternoon.
I think that is everyone. If I missed anyone? All right. With that, let's move on to our agenda. So this group, the UGM subcommittee, I'll explain a little bit more about it as we get going, but it is a subcommittee of Thurston Regional Planning Council. It hasn't met in quite a long time, but this group does typically have a chair and vice chair that kind of helps just to guide the meeting. And so we don't have any designated officers for this group. So what I'm looking for now is if there members of the subcommittee who would volunteer to serve for this meeting as a chair for this committee.
I would be interested in that.
Okay, so we have one nomination, Clark Gilman. Anyone else? And then I will put it to the group. I guess give it one more time. Is there anyone? Any other nominations for chair? And hearing none, I'll put it to the group for this meeting. All those who approve naming Clark Gilman as chair of the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee for today's meeting, signify by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? Welcome, Chair Gilman. I think I'll look to see if we have any nominations for anyone who would like to serve as a vice chair. Again, just for this meeting, and since we have a chair, unlikely to be many duties associated with this, but for the record.
I'll take the low risk position.
Thank you so much, Councilmember Miller. Any other nominations? Hearing none, I'll put it to the group. All those in favor of appointing Malcolm Miller vice chair for the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, those are your officers, your chair, Clerk Gilman, vice chair, Malcolm Miller. Thank you so much. And then I will hand over these duties to our chair, Clerk Gilman, looking through our agenda.
Great. Thank you, Allison. And I thank you for allowing me to chair the meeting. So we convened under Allison's lead at 2 o'clock, and now we're up to approval of the agenda. Is there somebody who's had a chance to review the agenda and might make a motion?
I move that we approve the agenda.
Great. And there's a second. Great. It's been moved by Eileen and seconded by Dennis. Is there any discussion or amendments of the agenda as published? Hearing no discussion, all in favor of approving the agenda as published, say aye.
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 All right. And I just a point of clarification, is Commissioner Mensah a member of the committee, and we're making recommendations to the commission, or what's your job, Ty?
Yes, I will clarify that a member of the Board of 13 County Commissioners both is a member of the UGM subcommittee according to the countywide planning policies, and Commissioner Mensah is the designated representative to this group from the county.
Great. So we'll watch for your votes on the conference room camera there. Thank you for the clarification.
The question.
Go ahead, Malcolm.
The correspondence said that there, webinar with an in-person option, but with no address shown for the in-person option. For future meetings, will there be an address, or what is the address for the in-person option?
On the agenda, you're right. No, on the agenda, as we said, TRPC provides access at Thurston Regional Planning Council's Conference Room A, that is at 2411 Chandler Court, Southwest in Olympia, Washington.
Thank you.
All right, the next item is public comment. Allison, did we have anybody register for public comment?
We do have a few folks who are attending in person, but online. And I believe there might be some folks who wish to provide comment. And so if you are attending the meeting and would like to provide comment to the committee at this time, please use the raise your hand function and we'll bring you in. You'll have, I think 3 minutes to provide comments. We'll come in and unmute you, and then you'll be able to provide your comment to the committee.
Great. So David Toyer has a hand up.
Great. So let's bring on David.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Appreciate your time. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
David Toyer with Toyer Strategic Advisors. We're the consultant representing the Black Lake Quarry proposal that was originally proposed as a UGA expansion, but we've also proposed an alternative, which would be a rural rezone. Not sure all of the packet of information in which you received as a committee, but our request is if you do recommend an unfavorable approach to the UGA expansion, that you encourage the Board of Commissioners to evaluate the rural rezone as an alternative, which actually the rural rezone is our preferred alternative on our end. We'd rather have the rural rezone than the UGA expansion. But anyways, just wanted to briefly address you this morning or this afternoon. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Great, thank you for the comment. And we may call on you later in our work. We don't generally make the public comment a two-way conversation. And Carolyn Wilmofsky also has a hand up.
Carolyn, you should be able to unmute yourself and speak.
You can hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. Anyway, our property at 6711 198th Avenue Southwest has been in our family for over 50 years. For the last 20 years, we've been trying to have the UGA to rezone our property. I think it's terribly unfair that you've allowed other houses and apartment buildings to be built all around us. We're kind of like an island. And so we would sure appreciate your consideration to rezone our property.
Thank you, Ms. Wilmofsky, for coming in to comment. Thank you. All right. Is there anybody else who wishes to make public comment this afternoon?
You're like a ghost.
Allison, is there anybody else in the conference room with you?
There isn't anyone else in the conference room with me, Chair. And for folks joining us through the Zoom who came in a little late, if you wish to provide comment, you can use the raise your hand function and let us know you wish to provide comment. But Chair, at this time, I'm not seeing any other comments.
All right, well then I will mute myself and turn it over to you for the overview of the role of the UGM subcommittee.
Chair, I will correct that. It looks like we do have one more person who would like to provide public comment. It looks like Ryan Duskins has raised his hand.
Yeah, thank you for taking my comment real briefly. We're located here in Grand Mound and have a business here in Grand Mound, and we're starting to really experience a lot of issues that come with a growing area. And I think largely people just think the Grand Mound, there's nothing going on in sleepy little Grand Mound, but there's definitely things going on in sleepy Grand Mound. And I really encourage planning to really plan and think ahead of what that looks like and the ways that we get ahead of that. And I think jobs and housing are key so that we can have the resources to do what we need to do. I think this UGA expansion is a big thing, and I think we should do it right and plan ahead and understand that we can't stop growth. We need to just plan growth. And so I'm hoping that's what we do here, and look forward to hearing what you guys have to say.
Great. Thank you for your comment, Mr. Deskins. All right, now I'll turn it over to Allison to begin the presentation.
Let me just pull this up. All right, I'll give a little overview of the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee just to reorient folks on what this group is, because it has been a long time since it's met. So the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee is a standing committee of Thurston Regional Planning Council. This is not a committee that meets regularly. It meets as needed, and it provides interjurisdictional consultation as required under the Growth Management Act. The countywide planning policies that govern the way we plan together in the Thurston region includes references to the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee as a vehicle to provide the intergovernmental coordination required through GMA. The UGM subcommittee includes representatives from all the cities and towns in Thurston County, as well as from Thurston County itself. And for the purposes of this meeting, because of a change to state law that we'll talk about a little bit more, we've also invited tribes who are located in the Thurston County region to also participate in this subcommittee. The UGM subcommittee has two primary roles. Those roles are to review and make recommendations to the Board of County Commissioners on any proposed changes to the urban growth area boundary, and to review and make recommendations to the Board of County Commissioners on revisions to the countywide planning policies. So in both of these cases, the Growth Management Act, the decision-making authority over urban growth area boundaries, and the final countywide planning policies, that decision is made at the Board of County Commissioners. But GMA says there must be interjurisdictional coordination before that those decisions are made, and this subcommittee provides the forum for that coordination. Today, we'll be talking about two requests that are before the subcommittee about amending the urban growth boundary. So I want to walk you through what that process looks like. So the first step is that cities and towns need to confer with the county about any proposed boundary amendment. And then a proposal for the boundary amendment needs to be sent to the UGM subcommittee for its consideration. The UGM subcommittee will make a recommendation, potentially what we'll do later today. They'll make a recommendation to the Board of County Commissioners. And once that recommendation is transmitted to the Board of County Commissioners, the Board of County Commissioners will hold a public hearing, which could be a part of, its full public process on some kind of update, and ultimately will make a decision on the boundary change. If there are any cities or towns at that time that disagree with the request, with the change in the boundary, they can request mediation through the Department of Commerce.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, can I ask a question? Ty.
Clark, you're muted.
Yes, absolutely. Commissioner Ty, go ahead.
The cities that disagree, is that any city can disagree, or is it only the city that's connected to the boundary adjustment? And in the case of Grand Mound, where there is no city, could any city disagree with that?
I believe it's any city within my understanding, it's any city within Thurston County or town. The idea being that the urban growth management boundary, the urban boundary in this forum, is one that we're negotiating or sharing across the region. And so all jurisdictions have a voice in what that boundary looks like, especially because things like our population projections are distributed across the community. It's not just jurisdiction by jurisdiction. It's done at sort of a broader level. So there's that interconnectedness. Moving on. The countywide planning policies lay out criteria for both setting urban growth boundaries and for amending them. So under policy 2.2, boundaries of the urban growth area must be areas characterized by urban growth. They must be served or planned to be served by municipal utilities. They must contain vacant land or underdeveloped land with additional capacity that are near existing urban areas. They must be compatible with the use of designated resource lands and critical areas. They must follow logical boundaries, consider citizen preferences, and be of sufficient area and densities to permit urban growth, the growth that's projected to occur in the succeeding 20 years. The two requests in front of you today are both requests for expanding the existing urban growth boundary. And in that case, under policy 2.4, South County jurisdictions and Grand Mound would fall under this category. For expansions of their boundaries, they must be shown to be served by municipal water and transportation in the next 20 years and have sewage disposal measures in the next 20 years. For North County jurisdictions, which would include request from the City of Lacey, the expansion area needs to show it can be served by municipal sewer, water, and transportation in the succeeding 20 years. In addition, any request to amend urban growth boundaries must meet all of the following criteria. Urbanization within the area would be compatible with the use of designated resource lands and critical areas. The expansion area must be contiguous to an existing urban growth boundary, and the expansion must be consistent with other countywide planning policies. And in addition to this criteria, at least one of the two following criteria must be met. There either must be shown to be insufficient land within the existing urban growth boundary to permit growth that is forecast to occur in the next 20 years, or the applicants must demonstrate an overriding public interest, demonstrating a public benefit beyond the area proposed for inclusion, that there would be that this overriding public benefit. That could include protecting public health, safety and welfare, enabling more cost-effective, efficient provision of sewer or water, or enabling the locally adopted comprehensive plans to more effectively meet goals of the GMA.
I had a question there too.
And Mr. that's Chair. A good spot for any questions from the committee. I'll turn it over to you, Chair.
Oh, go ahead, Commissioner Mensah.
So on the criteria of insufficient land to permit urban growth forecast, how many subcategories of land can you look at? I mean, land versus, I often see just like residential versus commercial / industrial, then, but say within commercial industrial, there's all sorts of subgroups and you might have enough commercial / industrial, but you don't have enough light industrial, or you might have enough housing, but you don't have enough multifamily housing, or, you know, how do we have to stick within just land, or do we have designated categories that we're trying to make sure that we have, that we're evaluating whether the land is sufficient?
It's an excellent question. The guidance that we have comes from the countywide planning policies and does not specify subcategories. It only says what's shown here, that just that there is insufficient land within the urban growth boundary to permit the urban growth that is forecast.
So it might be within the purview of this committee to look more at subcategories and try to achieve.
I think it would be on the proposers to demonstrate how their proposal meets the criteria in the countywide planning policies. And it would be for this subcommittee to review what's been proposed and consider whether it meets the criteria that's in front of you. But there isn't anything in the countywide planning policies that specifically splits that into different land use categories, saying you could meet some but not others.
And is the reference point for this sufficient land, the buildable lands forecast that TRPC conducts?
I think that is one source of information that folks could use. The countywide planning policies do not specify that that is the report that should be used to test this criteria. I can stop sharing and see if we have any other questions from committee members.
Any other questions about the process or our charge? I think we're good for this description of the process, Allison.
Great. Then I think this agenda item, then we're good to move on, Chair, to the next item.
Yes, please, to incorporating tribal coordination policies into countywide planning.
Okay. Thanks all. Let me get my slides up. Okay. So I apologize. You've seen a couple different messages about this agenda item. My name is Casey Mock. I'm an associate planner here at TRPC. Today, I'll just be presenting some information about changes in state law that will affect our countywide planning policies. So at this meeting, we are not recommending as staff that you send proposed amendments to the Board of County Commissioners, but we will have a recommendation for you going forward. I have a pretty quick presentation. I'll give a little bit of information about what the countywide planning policies are and how they're updated. I'll then talk about changes to state law that are triggering a potential change and end with a staff recommendation. So the countywide planning policies are a requirement under the Growth Management Act, and the law also lays out several required elements that the policies have to have. The purpose of the policies is to make sure that county and city comprehensive plans are coordinated, with special emphasis on regional issues and issues that affect common borders. And the process to update these policies is in the policies themselves, Section 11. And that general process is at least four jurisdictions request review. The Urban Growth Management Subcommittee can send the request to the planning directors to provide technical assistance if they wish. And then this returns to the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee to review amendments and forward a recommendation on to the Board of County Commissioners for their ultimate approval. The reason we're bringing this up today is because in 2022, the legislature amended the Growth Management Act to incorporate tribal participation and coordination. And there are a few different changes, some that affect comprehensive planning, and then some changes that specifically pertain to countywide planning policies. So in terms of the changes to countywide planning policy, there's two big parts. One is that the countywide planning policies have to have policies that address the protection of tribal cultural resources in collaboration with affected tribes. And the second requirement is just regarding how tribes are invited into the process. So it talks about how federal agencies and federally recognized Indian tribes whose reservations or ceded lands lie within the county shall be invited into the countywide planning policy adoption and update process. So at first, based on these legislative changes, staff did draft some proposed amendments, but on further review, we are suggesting that the subcommittee sends this request to the planning directors to provide technical assistance and a closer look into this, and also work with affected tribes on what they would like to see in this language. And then this can be brought back to the UGM subcommittee at a future date for you all to review and forward any recommendations on to the Board of County Commissioners. That's all I've got for you today. So I'm going to stop sharing and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Great. Thank you, Casey. Do we have questions for Casey? And I would also really appreciate hearing from Amy and David about how the process has gone so far and what we might do to make sure you have a chance to weigh in before we have our next meeting.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and just make a comment. I don't know that I've really received all the information yet about all of this. I was a little confused. I think there's supposed to be a smaller meeting maybe that I've signed up for already that is in the future, kind of describing what's going to be happening here. But I wasn't quite ready for today's meeting with I have not actually seen the amendments to the Urban Growth Management Act. So it's a little confusing right now for me. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, David. Amy?
I can speak to, I guess we would like to see what recommendations that come forth on involving tribes. I know that we've seen the different proposals for expansion in Grand Mound before. So those have been sent here. And I we never knew really what the process was to provide comment on that. So yeah, I think getting something formalized on how we can do that would be great.
Perfect. So are there other questions or comments? And it just to check my understanding, Casey, you're saying you've given us this initial look, but there's going to be more consultation with the tribes and staff work before there's a decision ready, both about the protecting cultural assets and the consulting tribes in planning policies.
Correct. So what we're looking for today is direction from the subcommittee to send this topic to the planning directors for their further review to return back to this group at a later date.
I got a question, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead, Ty. Yes.
So I had thought that the issue about what was about the draft in the first packet we got, there was a draft, I guess those were staff changes, about how we would consult with tribes on countywide planning policies. And then, but both David and Amy mentioned the specific jurisdiction proposals, which I understand we're discussing later in this meeting. So is the tribal input piece related to both of those, or is it more about the countywide planning policy and new language, if that makes sense? And should we, and thereby, if they, that's an avenue for them to properly make comment on the specific proposals, do we need to give them more time to be able to do that?
Allison, I can take this one and maybe you'll want to follow up. So this does affect the way urban growth boundary revisions are reviewed, only in the way that right now in the countywide planning policies, tribes are not listed as members of the UGM subcommittee. But to meet the intent of this law, tribes were invited to this meeting and therefore will have that same level of input and information that the other jurisdictions have. So this is a change we'll need to make moving forward, but it doesn't need to be made today to bring them into the process for these revisions.
Okay, unless there was a vote on something today, right? And then they're here, but they wouldn't necessarily have the vote that they might have later and should have, or? I wasn't sure how this whole process rolled. And I had a meeting with staff earlier today where they said these are often handled in like one meeting, and I know we have a placeholder meeting in about a couple of weeks, but I didn't realize we would be moving so fast. I mean, I've been studying these proposals as a county commissioner for months and months and months, years. So I just want to make sure that we go fast as we need to, but not too fast. If we're still working on integrating tribal vote and stuff in the process, then I don't mind to slow down for that if that's appropriate.
I would say, I'll jump in, Casey. And I think that's at the discretion of the subcommittee for today's meeting. There has been this change in state law. Our countywide planning policies have not been updated to account for it. We need a little more time to work out exactly how that's going to work. That said, we do have the process in place today, and we have our tribal representatives who are able to participate in the meeting today. You know, I think we have that option to hold on making a recommendation if the subcommittee wants to wait, or to move forward if you feel like it's more appropriate to wait until these revisions have been made. I think it is we're in a weird space with it because like many proposals, they're ready to move forward now. We're trying to reflect and catch up with things as fast as we can, but the policies are not quite there yet.
And so the effective date of these policies is?
So right now, any changes to the countywide planning policies would need to be reviewed by this group and send a recommendation to the Board of County Commissioners. And the Board of County Commissioners would need to hold their own public hearing on it and make a final decision. And so even if this group were to make some change today, it would still need to go through a number of steps before there could be a change in the countywide policies.
Malcolm, did that answer your question?
Well, I guess what I'm trying to get at is if in 2022 the legislature amended the GMA to incorporate tribal participation, and we're in 2023, then how? I mean, we apparently already had the time to, you know, allow them to be voting members. Is that, does that make sense? Because here we are, you know, in quarter two, in this meeting. And I guess the question kind of sounds to me like, you know, are they voting members today? And by law, it looks like they are, but that's as far as, that's the way I see it in this situation is that, you know, this already happened. And, you know, here we are 5 months and 5 days later, you know, questioning if it's valid for today, or how does that?
My sense is that there's an effective date of the legislation, but then that is a requirement for the county level government to implement the policy changes to make it so. And I think that's, if I understand right, Ty, that's your question, is should we first formally include the tribes in this committee and adopt this policy for, or recommend a policy for consulting the tribes in county level planning before we would decide these urban growth boundary issues? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I guess we could take the tack of, you know, is, like the committee, subcommittee might could say to itself, well, if there's no disagreement, you know, everybody seems on board, we could move forward. But if there's real disagreement or concern, you know, I'd be a little bit nervous for the reasons Councilmember Miller mentioned, or Deputy Mayor Miller mentioned, about taking a vote that might be a split vote if we haven't, you know, really got on the stick and gotten the countywide planning policies in line with state law. I don't know if there was a timeline. I think what you say, Clark, is exactly, makes sense. It's how they usually do it, but sometimes they give us deadlines to do these things. Sometimes they don't. Sounds like maybe this one they didn't.
This one, it's not a clear deadline on this one.
Okay.
But I think an option for the subcommittee is that we have our tribal representatives here today. You could include them in your decision-making process on the two items that are before you. And come back, because there are other, we know that there will be other changes likely coming for the countywide planning policies. In addition, this is just the one that was specifically called out in law, but there might be other ones that from our the planning directors that they might want to bring back as a fuller group. And we know that this is one that will need to be addressed as part of that. But that very issue is why we wanted to, because this group was convening, we wanted to address it in the meeting today, because it does, this change in state law does create an expectation for tribal consultation as part of this work.
So does the county need to put forth some type of an ordinance or something for that to happen in this county, or is it because it's now RCW that it's currently in place and enforceable? I don't, because if we just need a motion to include them in today's actions, is that what's being asked here?
So I'll leave it to Allison to answer if this group has the leeway to include the tribal members in the vote and in the motion. The ask today is to send this to the planning directors so that we can get it onto the review schedule. But there's a couple, you know, proposed changes. One is formally adding tribes into the UGM subcommittee. And that's the change that gives them a vote and a seat at the table with these boundary revisions. The other policies that are required address protection of tribal cultural resources. And that's a more nuanced change that requires some time for the planning directors and tribal stakeholders to get together and really define what those policies would look like.
Ryan, you're going to add some wisdom here.
Yeah, thanks. So Ryan Andrews, staff with the City of Lacey. Give me 1 second. I'm going to share my screen and hopefully maybe this will help. Let me find how to. All right, you all see that? Okay.
Yep.
So what TRPC staff is asking is, so there's some requirements of state law that require countywide planning policies to be updated to recognize tribal input into this process. Under section 11.3, this is an existing section within the countywide planning policies, basically says that amendments to the countywide planning policies must use the following process. The first one there, which is not highlighted, says that proposed amendments have to be reviewed by the subcommittee that then makes recommendation to the Board of County Commissioners. Step B there, which is highlighted, says technical assistance will be provided to the UGM subcommittee by jurisdictional planning directors or their designated representatives. And so what TRPC is asking you to do is to use option B, which is, or not option B, but section B, which is required prior to providing any formal recommendations. So I don't believe that you need to have any action taken. This is more of a procedural item that TRPC staff is sharing with you to tell you kind of what is going to happen. There is some technical assistance that needs to be done, coordination between the planning directors and tribal representatives to come up with the language that'll tell you exactly what needs to be included in the countywide planning policies. Once that process has concluded, then they will be back with language, proposed language that will be in front of you to amend the countywide planning policies for you then to make a recommendation onto the Board of County Commissioners. So I hope that helps answer. I don't believe that there's necessarily any action that you need to take today. They're basically briefing you on a process that needs to occur and will be done in consultation between the planning directors and the tribal representatives.
And I would concur with what Ryan just said. This is Jeremy from Thurston County. Thank you, Ryan.
Great. So we're clear that we don't have to specifically refer this item about incorporating tribal coordination anywhere, but we still need to make a decision as a group about whether we would act on the other two items that are on the agenda today without under the rules as Ryan just screen shared them, which are the cities and counties, city and county representatives making the recommendation to the Board of Commissioners. Dennis, Eileen, would you like to weigh in here?
Yeah, I would. I think we need to quit dancing and call the music. The tribes are an important part of this county in the process. And I say, let's put them in here permanently and give them the vote.
Second.
So to follow up on that, so then he's, Dennis is asking that we install the vote to install the tribes today then so they could participate or wait. I'm confused about this.
I think we're here. We have a job to do. Let's include them and get busy.
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, Eileen. Ty? How do you see a path for us allowing the tribal representatives to have a voice in the decision today? I'm torn between what's written on paper in the process that we're described mm-hmm. and the fact that we're all here in the room.
Well, I mean, I read my packet, but I wasn't thinking about this issue and reading it with this issue in mind. So I don't know that I mean, I'm with Dennis in spirit, but I don't know if we have to go through this procedural process of only the Board of County Commissioners can amend the countywide planning policies and thereby change the membership of the UGM subcommittee and who the voting members are. If that's a process that must be followed, then I would say we basically say in spirit, this committee will treat them as voting members today. And if there's a split vote on something, we wait. And that's where I would be on it. And we could basically just get to the same practical result without the formality of them being actually voted members, if that's not possible because the Board of County Commissioners hasn't voted, if that makes sense.
Thank you. So I think we've heard several similar comments. And I'll just ask, is there anybody on the committee who would have a concern with including Amy and David's participation on behalf of the Chehalis and Nisqually tribes as part of our conversation and our recommendation to the commissioners today? Great. Well, then I would say that we likely will have a future meeting where this set of tribal coordination policies would come back for recommendations, but I think we're okay to move forward with the Grand Mound and Lacey urban growth boundary discussions. Is that okay with people?
It is.
Right. Allison, please continue on for us.
Wonderful. I'd like to invite up Caitlin Nelson from Thurston County. She's going to present item number 7, Thurston County's request to amend the Grand Mound urban growth boundary.
Okay, good afternoon. I am Caitlin Nelson. Let me share my screen. There we go. Sorry about that. Okay. You should have all received a packet of materials for these proposals with much more detailed information than I plan on going over today. But there are three separate proposals here, known as Wilmofsky, Deskin, and Black Lake Quarry. These proposals were reviewed with the Grand Mound Subarea Plan and a handful of other rezone requests that did not request a change to the urban growth area. And the Planning Commission recommended denial of these requests as they did not find them to be consistent with the comprehensive plan or the countywide planning policies. But this UGM subcommittee will review the recommendation, create your own recommendation, and that will be provided to the board prior to a public hearing and final decision. Can you see my mouse?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I just wanted to point out the properties on this map here. We have Wilmofsky right here on the west. North of that is Black Lake Quarry. And then we have Deskin's property over here on the east side of the Grand Mound urban growth area. This map includes the zoning, some aerial imagery, and a water layer. And these are estimates. They are not exact known locations. So you see there are some wetlands on some properties that may or may not be verified. There was also a Planning Commission public hearing on these properties where public comment included a handful of comments against an expansion to the UGA, some supporting growth in general. A comment from WashDOT with concern over the impact of transportation with any UGA expansion and support for the expansions from the applicants. I'm going to start with the Wilmofsky property. It's currently zoned low residential RRR1 unit per 5 acres with a request to rezone to the R4 to 16 per one unit, 4 to 16 units per 1 acre zoning district. This could allow for up to 464 units. There are some blocks of, here's an aerial imagery. There are some blocks surrounding the property of R3 to 6 per 1 acre and R4 to 16 per 1 acre in Grand Mound that are still undeveloped. The surrounding density is about at the R3 to 6 per 1 acre. And there is no R4 to 16 per 1 acre zoning districts adjacent to this property. There are concerns with providing enough affordable housing in the county, and the comprehensive plan is expected to look closer at housing needs in the comprehensive plan over the next year by state law. Next, we have the Deskin property. It is currently zoned low residential RRR one unit per 5 acres with a request to rezone to the arterial commercial zone. As shown on this map, there are potential wetlands on site that would need to be studied further prior to development. There are also adjacent properties zoned arterial commercial and light industrial that are within the urban growth area. And then there are also low density residential properties surrounding the rest of the property. Black Lake Quarry, it's currently zoned low residential, one unit per 5 acres, but it is considered a natural resource use as it's used for mining. And that is proposed to be rezoned to light industrial. There are environmental concerns with both options on this property. If no change to the property, the applicant has stated that the mining may continue past the water line. But if developed, there are concerns with filling the mining site and allowing other industrial uses. The property is also adjacent to low density residential uses and some other light industrial zoning. Okay, so state law does provide that the county shall include areas and densities sufficient to permit urban growth that is projected to occur over the next 20 years. Guidance generally includes that prior to expanding the UGA, that other action be prioritized to either upzone undeveloped areas or update policies to encourage building within the already established UGA. So that should be considered with this. The buildable lands report does state that there is sufficient land capacity for development in the UGA in general. And we have provided some information on what kind of changes these properties may create. Allison already went over some of the countywide planning policies, so I won't go into too much detail, but the properties are anticipated to be served by municipal water and sewer with a closer look at the transportation capacity prior to an approval. Compatibility with...
If I may,
yeah.
So the point one, the expansion will be served by municipal water, sewer, and transportation. Because this is an unusual one and it's not adjacent to a city or an urban area, what does that mean about municipal utilities in a place that isn't going to connect itself to a city?
So great question. Thurston County does have a water system plan and a sewer system plan, and we do serve Grand Mound. And so basically what we did is we're currently drafting our water system plan, or I should say it is drafted. It has been sent to Department of Ecology for a first review. And we are looking at the amount of water rights that we have, where the connections are, what we would expect to expand to in the next 20 years. And we looked at whether or not these proposals would be capable of being served in our water service area and whether or not we had enough water rights to serve them. And I think the answer was essentially yes, even if they are not currently in the water service area, since we are in the process of updating it and we have the capacity, they would then be included in that if we went that route. Okay. Yeah, just in general, if I continue on with that, we need to consider compatibility with the potential critical areas with each of these properties. Each property is in fact contiguous with the urban growth area. The other section of 2.4 is requiring that an expansion must demonstrate either that there is insufficient land within the UGA over the next 20 years, or there must be an overriding public interest with a public benefit relating to one of the listed options. Generally, each of these proposals have provided information on how the proposal meets these policies. The Planning Commission had quite a bit of discussion over them and ended up providing a recommendation that they found that they did not. But I am coming to you and asking for a recommendation on your analysis. So at this point, I can ask or I can answer any additional questions that you have.
I'm going to go ahead again and ask if it's not the you've shown quite a bit of excess capacity from the buildable lands. So the second point, is there a case that staff would make about the provision of utilities, the demonstrating the public interest?
Okay, so there are a couple parts to that. There was not a lot of public interest in either approval or denial of the property. There was maybe a handful of each. There has been argument discussed about whether or not there would be a public benefit served with each of these proposals. Each of the applicants generally suggests that it would benefit Grand Mound to approve these. Maybe we need more commercial, we need more residential, it's not being built, and we need more industrial. I currently don't have additional information other than the buildable lands report on whether or not the exact request that they're asking for would be needed there. There is an industrial land study that is being completed by the county at the moment that isn't expected to be finished until maybe the end of the year. Like I mentioned, the comprehensive plan is requiring that we look more at what income bracket is necessary in each area. So we don't have the data on that, and that would be supported. For Blacklight Quarry, there is an argument to be made possibly about whether or not there's an environmental impact by continuing to mine versus developing it as industrial. I think at this point, from a staff perspective, there's nothing that is clearly making this a approve or deny. So I would be really interested in hearing what kind of input others would have on that.
Right. Well, this is our opportunity to weigh in.
I have a quick question. You mentioned before there was a group that did not approve this moving forward. Could you say who that was again and what that process was?
Oh, that was the Thurston County Planning Commission. They reviewed each of these proposals, reviewed it with the countywide planning policies and the comprehensive plan policies. And they definitely had concern with each of the things that I listed. They're concerned about affordable housing, whether or not providing additional residential uses would help with that. There are concerns about whether or not the commercial uses in Grand Mound are sufficient, or whether or not industrial is needed, since it is an area of growth. I think ultimately it came down to this this section of code requiring of countywide planning policies requiring demonstrating a public benefit beyond the proposed inclusion, and whether or not there was supporting information other than just the buildable lands report. The fact that we had to keep coming back to the buildable lands report made it difficult, I think, for the Planning Commission in their like very narrow scope of work and review capabilities to make a suggestion beyond that. Sorry, I think I trailed off a little bit there, but hopefully that wasn't too much.
And Gary, we didn't get a chance to have you introduce yourself at the beginning of the meeting. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Oh, sure. I'm Gary Cooper, Planning and Building Manager at City of Yelm. Sorry I was a little late, but
thank you.
I've heard most of the discussion. I did want to say, I mean, based on the buildable lands memo, I guess, the table showing the excess capacity for both residential and industrial, I would think that they would need to have some overriding reason to expand the UGA, and I haven't really heard anything to that effect. So I guess I'm not seeing an expansion being justified. My personal feeling there, but I am curious, do you know if Black Lake Quarry has a reclamation plan?
I know that they do. I have not seen it, and I don't know that they legally have to share it. I'm not sure of the details of that.
Sure.
Chair. Other questions for Caitlin? Oh, go ahead.
Commissioner Mentor, but guys, question.
Absolutely.
Okay. So this is kind of a comment, kind of what Caitlin said there about, you know, the Planning Commission. I think they really had to conclude what Gary just kind of concluded based on TRPC's buildable lands, and that's why I asked the question at the beginning of the meeting about, well, is that the only source information? And Allison said it's not. And do we have to stick with the categories that are there? And it sounds like we don't. That's where I got kind of tied up with this whole thing as I've learned about these proposals, because I think there is a case there, depending on how granular you get into this sub area. For example, with housing, the new, you know, you could say there's enough land for housing, but the state says we now have to go a little deeper than that and look at income brackets and types of housing. And we haven't finished that analysis, but I think when we do, I'm guessing that from preliminary, what I've heard from staff is that there are going to be gaps at the lower end. And that might support, you know, if we look at that subcategory, there might be insufficient land to meet the housing need at that income bracket, for example. That would relate to Wilmofsky. On Black Lake, there's another, you know, arguments about the light industrial. You know, I've looked at the light industrial zoning in Grand Mound, and it looks like there's a number there, but most of it is owned by one other property owner that's mined it super deep, and it's just a lake that couldn't actually ever become light industrial. So if you look kind of like one level deeper, it starts to look like there may be gaps that don't appear when you're at that higher TRPC buildable land study level. So I wasn't sure how to navigate this, and I was kind of talking this through with staff today, and we were just thinking, you know, I want to get the right answer, at least in terms of my vote for these projects. But, you know, I also know that this group is constrained by the information on the table. You're not going to take my word for it or an applicant's word for it. So I was thinking potentially to suggest that we defer a decision on these projects, because I know the county has work underway that should provide more information, concrete information. The industrial land study that the board has allocated resources and is underway, that was recommended by the Planning Commission because they were struggling with these decisions. And so that's underway. And then we've got this new imperative to deal more deeply with the housing income bracket piece as part of our comp plan update. So I think all of this information, you know, I don't mean to stifle anybody's questions or debate about it, but and if everybody thinks these are good ideas, fine. But if there's concern because you're just kind of stuck with what we've got from the buildable land study, there is going to be more information coming around the corner. And I would hope there's an option to defer a recommendation. And then I would go to the Board of County Commissioners and say, you know, we may need to do what we can to get this information facilitated so that, you know, this work can move. I want these decisions made, but I want them to, the right decisions on the right information. So.
Thanks, Ty. Other thoughts or questions right now?
Yeah, Clark, I share Commissioner Mensah's, because when I was going through this, I had a question. It was like, about the comp plans. We're all tasked with updating our comp plans. So are we, with that in mind, you know, we would, it seems like we need to wait until the jurisdictions and especially the county has an opportunity to complete the reports that Commissioner Mensler said, and also looking at the comprehensive plan, because I really think it's going to change things for some jurisdictions. So.
Other thoughts right now?
I think definitely, I think be wise to wait for more information to surface. I'm also curious if this commission or this subcommittee, when we make a decision, is it for all three of these projects together? It almost seems like they're kind of, you know, enough differences that one might make traction better by on its own rather than being lumped in with all three.
No, I would request a separate recommendation for each property.
Agreed.
Thanks, David. Malcolm, Dennis, Amy, any thoughts you want to share now?
No.
I can speak for the Chehalis tribe since we have a lot of development in Grand Mound, and we definitely support more housing down here. There is not enough for sure. So I'll just throw that out there. And, you know, that Grand Mound area is a developing area, and we'd like to see it grow more commercially and get some more homes for jobs and for people down here. So I'll just leave it at that.
Are you good right now, Malcolm?
Well, you know, I can't help but think, you know, as the growth plan, you know, suggests that, you know, we stick to building in these specified areas, and that being the case, you know, the lands that have been identified as more desirable are not in those specified areas, and so I'm kind of just thinking, you know, is it just a matter of geography, or is it something else that, you know, makes these areas more desirable for development than the areas that are have already been outlined for us to develop? So that's where that is, just a point of curiosity for me, you know. And it looks like in this situation, maybe we don't have all the intel that we need to make this decision. And maybe it's that, you know, the UGAs have, you know, already been studied, and we know for a fact, you know, but you know, I just with the requests, I mean, this is a lot of acreage being requested outside of the area. And if it's more prime for development, why isn't it already included? If it's just a few questions that I have as I listen and try to, you know, figure out, you know, how can a decision be made on these? But at the same time, it looks like, you know, we don't have everything we need to fulfill, you know, I guess you want to call it the law, and really understand, you know, the decision that we're making in this case, in some of these cases.
All right, Eileen.
I was just reviewing the date of the application too, and I don't know if that, does that factor in on this? Because a lot of the questions that were asked, it looks like it was done in 2008. And so a lot of the questions there weren't answered. So most of the questions weren't answered as far as environmental impact and different things, you know, how many houses that they plan to put in there. So that part I'm curious about, because it's such an old application. Do they need to reapply, or how does this get updated? Because I'm with what was just said too, that we don't have updated information to make a decision there.
I believe we could just request additional information from the applicants without an official application. But the other thing to keep in mind is that since these are rezone requests, the we weren't reviewing this with the intention of attaching their proposal to the rezone. So they could end up building something other than what they're proposing, as long as it's within the zoning requirements.
Mm-hmm. Great. And I want to acknowledge that we now have representation from the great city of Tenino. So John O'Callaghan has joined us. Hi, John.
Thank you. Sorry I'm late.
Sure. I'm really got Ty's suggestion echoing in my ears. I'm thinking, here's what I'm thinking is, it's been 14 years or something since this body's met. So maybe we're convening to get the machine starting to move again. We clearly have a shared interest in having additional information, and some of that is already in process from other countywide efforts. And I think to my mind, we have a need for another meeting, both to hear the tribal work, and I believe the planning directors, at least from Olympia's perspective, the planning directors are likely to make other suggestions that would update the countywide planning policies to be currently in line with the urban with the Growth Management Act. I would be interested in how people think we might make a motion or a recommendation along these lines.
Is that a hand up?
Here, it looks like Gary Cooper has a hand up.
Oh, I don't see you, but go ahead, Gary.
Can't hear you, Gary. We might have just lost it.
All right. Well.
Chair, if I may, I think what I'm hearing, I've heard a couple different things from the group, but I might just make a suggestion. It sounds like the subcommittee may need additional information before you would be ready to make a recommendation to the Board of County Commissioners on this item. And the subcommittee could specify what additional information you'd like to have before you'd be ready to make that recommendation. And we could reconvene the subcommittee when that information is available and you'd have time to review it. That would be an option for the group. I do see that Gary Cooper is back. And Gary, I know you had your hand up before, so I'm not sure.
Thanks. Yeah, I don't know why it keeps kicking me out, but anyway, I do concur with what Ty said. I mean, if there is a finer level of information that would show this is an extraordinary situation, then yeah, so be it. I mean, if we were to vote today on the information that we have in front of us, I would say it doesn't meet the planning policy criteria, but maybe there's more to be gained from looking into it deeper. And then just to harp on that reclamation plan thing a bit, they should have one. When you get a special use permit, it's a public document, and typically they are supposed to do reclamation in phases, and I would want to make sure that they were in compliance with their permits before I granted them an expansion of their use.
Okay. So Ty, could you help us with the right names for the staff for the effort to understand the need by income bracket for additional housing that's underway, and the industrial land study that's underway? What do we call those things?
Caitlin's probably the best one to, at least on the point of the housing data, because as I understand it, I don't know that we have to wait for the county's comp plan update, but I think we would want to see the housing and the data analysis that will inform that's being developed to inform the county's comp plan update. That's one thing. And second is the county's industrial land study. And that was actually recommended by the Planning Commission. The board took that recommendation and funded it. And I'm not sure the timetable on that, but I think Caitlin said toward the end of the year. But those are the two items that I think would most closely bear on the decisions that we have to make. Caitlin, do I have that right?
Yes.
So is there other specific information that people would want to have in addition to what we had in the packet before we would make a decision on these three proposals?
I think that I did hear a question about why are some of these properties that we have in the UGA not being developed. And so I would like to look at, I believe our utility map shows that there's kind of a chunk of missing utility extensions in that area. So I can try to look into information on that as well.
That's helpful. Eileen, go ahead.
So I don't know how far we can go into. You're asking about questions that we may have about the rezoning. My concern too, I guess probably the Planning Commission also was the number of wetlands that are on that site for the first one that we're looking at, the rezone to industrial. Sorry, looking at the arterial commercial district, they want to rezone to that. That area seems like it has a lot of wetlands. And then I would be curious to find out, because one of the statements they make is that they would have arterial, it could be an arterial usage alternative route to access the Tumwater industrial area. So what does the traffic plan look like? Is there a need for a traffic study? Are they running semis up and down Old 99? I just am curious what that would look like when he's proposing that it's an alternative route.
I think that based on the comment provided by Department of Transportation stating their concerns with an expansion to the UGA on transportation being, at the interchange, Highway 99, I-5, most likely there would be a transportation study for each of these properties if approval was sought. Mm-hmm.
Great. Are there any other comments or questions right now? And how shall we take action on would it be appropriate for us to create a motion that includes these additional information that we have, that we request that we have, saying that we'll reconvene when this information's available to consider these?
I do believe that would be the right way to go. There are a whole lot of questions just from the little bit that I've been here, never mind what I've got on my own. Then I've pretty much been along the same lines. But without that information to go ahead, it's kind of like, you know, waking up in the middle of the night, not turning lights on and stubbing your toe because you didn't know something was there.
So two timeline questions. One is, Caitlin, were you affirming Ty's sense that the studies would both have some information for us by the first of next year?
I don't know that we're on track for that with the housing information for the industrial land study. That is my expectation. I think we'd have to talk more about it to determine the timeline for all of these items.
Good. And then the other benefit to delaying this, as we stated earlier, is we can, with no questions, have the tribal governance representatives as part of the decision-making body, assuming that we get that work done in the interim.
I have a couple of questions about the requests themselves. Is this the first request for these properties to be moved into this type of zoning, or is this a second or a third request?
Good question. They have been on the Board of County Commissioner docket for several years, I believe, each of them at least. But I couldn't tell you the exact year that they applied. Jeremy, I don't know if you know more about that, but like Eileen mentioned, I think some of them do have a 2008 date.
Yeah, I believe the Will Mosky one dates back to 2008, and the board has continued up until this last year to roll any site-specific land use plan amendment and rezones in with the Grand Mound Sudbury plan update. And the county allocated staff for the Grand Mound Sudbury update probably about 4 years ago, and then started to work on that update. And so these are rolled into that. So that we can take a more comprehensive look at Grand Mound, its land uses, and what's going on down there, and roll the decisions into one decision on that plan update.
And to clarify, these have not been reviewed and denied. They just had not been reviewed.
Right, they'd been deferred. They were added to the docket, and then they were left on the docket with the Grand Mound there, Sudbury update, yeah, with no decisions by the board on a yes or no on any of the rezones or land use plan amendment changes. And I've been at the county since 2008, and I'm not aware of any other land use plan amendment requests for these specific properties the county received other than what's before you today.
And I'll just add that the Board of County Commissioners were, based on that long trajectory and projects kept getting added in, we've made this our number one priority for staff, this Grand Mary. This package, this bundle of projects and the Grand Mound Subarea Plan is the board's number one priority for our docket for this cycle.
And John, you had your hand up for a moment. Do you?
No, it got my question that was coming up got answered. Thank you.
Eileen.
And remind me again of the timing then of when the Board of County Commissioners, will it be something that you'll be doing after the first of the year? Is that when you'll be addressing these? If we defer this to later on, then is going to be on your project list for the upcoming year?
It will roll over. So right now it's on our project timeline. We're working on it. Just this additional information, these are just part of different projects. So it will continue. It will continue on to next year, most likely.
And Caitlin mentioned that to me before that the county commissioners have the latitude to sort of, we don't have to just pause all work and just freeze everything right now until this information that we've outlined comes in. We could direct staff to continue developing, whether it's an environmental impact statement or whatever it is we think might be needed, we can have that going forward on a parallel track. And I can't speak for the board, but that's something that I'm sure we'll discuss. So we're not proposing that everything just has to be frozen for the next 6 months or whatever. Because like I say, some of these projects are old and we want to get this bundle across the finish line, whether it's thumbs up or thumbs down, as soon as we can.
John, go ahead.
Why is it going to take 6 months to get the information that's been requested from this group to make a decision?
Well, the information that we are looking at updating the comprehensive plan with for the housing element, that is all new guidance. So we are working with TRPC and the other jurisdictions. So that's going to take a little while. The industrial land study has been ongoing. That's a totally separate project that we had not intended to be combined. So looking at that track. And then the environmental impact statement, it just is a timely project that will need to happen either way. So that would need, because of the way that we went about this, it would most likely be an RFP and we would hire a consultant to draft an EIS instead of having it go through the applicant.
And I would add some of the delay on issuing an RFP for these or request for qualifications, either one, is we do have to go through the county purchasing process to do that. And that does take a little bit of extra time. We can't necessarily always just hire a consultant off the street, depending on the dollar value of the contract. We may have to go before the Board of County Commissioners and issue and follow that purchasing process for those professional services.
And the reason that I ask that is because I'm looking at the people that I can see that are here, and every one of us have been involved in one way or another and what's going on in Thurston County, not just a little piece of Thurston County, but the entire county through TRPC, TPB, and every other alphabet group that's out there. If it's just hiring somebody to do the study, that's one thing. And at that point, I'm not so sure that we need to take 6 months just to get that started. Here in Tenino, when we need to hire somebody, a month, 45 days, and we've got the people that we need to do what we need to get done. So again, why is it going to take 6 months before it comes back to this group and before we can even think about making a decision? The problem, that's a problem that not just here in Thurston County or the state of Washington, but throughout the United States, that's always been the biggest complaint and the driver of all costs. And when you're talking affordability, you go from dollar A to all of a sudden dollar 10, just because of the time that it takes government to say, okay, let's do this. I can understand maybe a month and a half, 2 months to hire the people that need to be doing the studies. And the reason that I say that is because of just the timeline that it's taken so long just for us to discuss this stuff. I don't think we need to take 6 months and put them off again, because when you look at 6 months, and if you're looking at overall, and Clark has seen me do this before, you look down the future at overall things, and all I see are costs going up until a project can't be done. And that's not what we're here to do. We're here to help them move these things along. And this is a prime opportunity. So I still don't understand why we have to wait 6 months. I think we can meet a whole lot sooner with the information that's been requested so far from this group. And the only thing that we might have to wait on is the environmental study, which you say needs to be done one way or another anyway. If we know that study needs to be done, why wait? Just get it done and we can still move forward with everything else.
I didn't catch where 6 months came in, but the intention was to reschedule as soon as that information is available.
Yeah, that's where the 6 months came in. It started off saying that the beginning of the year, which is 6 months from now, because this is June, the sixth month. If we're waiting until the beginning of the year, that's 6 months, maybe seven. That's where that came in.
John, I appreciate that concern, and you know, Ty had also raised that we owe these folks a decision one way or another. They've waited a long time. I also think that the housing data analysis and the industrial lands, our efforts are already underway, and it's just the reality of the time that staff are anticipating before they can talk to us about how those two studies describe the Grand Mount area. So I both understand that let's just get it done. And I also know that 6 months at the speed of government is kind of like lightning speed. So
Yeah, I'm not advocating for let's just get it done. Let's get it done right. I just don't see that it takes that long to get it done right.
Yeah. All right. Is there anything else, or do you feel like we're ready to make a recommendation or decision here and move to our next item? How are you feeling, people? You still there?
it seems so late in the day. Everybody, are we all a little lethargic this afternoon?
I should have bought snacks. Yeah.
Are we just measured?
I can try a motion if you want, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Mensah. Please.
Okay, so I would make a motion to defer decision on the three Grand Mound items and to reconvene the subcommittee, the TRPC to reconvene the subcommittee upon receipt of the three items analysis that was identified here concerning industrial lands by Thurston County, analysis of housing data by income bracket as required by state law, and that will inform the county's comp plan update, and the county's informal analysis of why properties within the UGA currently haven't been or aren't in process of being developed. Caitlin said she could do that. So with those three items, we would reconvene the subcommittee and make recommendations.
Is that the motion?
That's my motion.
Second.
All right, it's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion on the motion? All right, all of those in favor, raise your hand and say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
And any opposed, say nay and shake your head. Okay, so we've passed the motion to defer until we have those three additional information packets. And Caitlin, thank you so very much for leading us through the conversation here.
Thank you.
Yes. We're going to move on to our next item, which is a request to amend the Lacey Urban Growth Boundary, and Ryan Andrews is here to explain this proposal.
Hi, yeah, thanks again for having me. We believe what we have today to present to you is a fairly straightforward proposal, and happy to answer any questions here today, but at the end, ultimately requesting that the urban growth area boundary amendment be referred to the Board of County Commissioners for their review and action. So with that, I get started here, sharing my screen. Okay, so in front of you today is a consideration for urban growth boundary amendment related to Cuyo Park. For those of you that are unfamiliar with Cuyo Park is located in the kind of the northwestern portion of Lacey, north of I-5. So if you are looking at this map and you can see the potential addition to the urban growth area outlined in red, the park itself actually extends to the south.
Excuse me, Ryan. Your slide didn't advance. You're still in we're seeing all the menu options of your. Showing the show yet.
How about that? What do you guys see?
Perfect. There it is.
Oh, as soon as I hit that, I got out of it. Let me try one more time.
Here's some, but if he's going to show that slide.
There it is.
Okay.
We've got the maps. All right.
All right. Okay. So just a reminder, this is north part of Lacey. So you can see I-5 to the south. The black lines are the street corridors. So running north and south is Carpenter Road. South of that is 15th, which runs into Dram Road and ultimately becomes Britton Parkway. And then north of that is Hawks Prairie Road. So the park itself actually extends from Hawks Prairie Road and the north eastern corner all the way almost down to 15th Avenue on the southern portion of the property. So these are the properties that are proposed for the boundary amendment. So the dark green areas, those are the ones that are already in Lacey city limits that are make up Kuya Park. So on the northeastern corner, that portion of the park touches Hawks Prairie Road and then comes and goes south and west towards Carpenter Road, goes across Carpenter, over to kind of the Pleasant Glade area. So there are a number of parcels being proposed for the amendment and as well some additional parcels that would also be included that would be surrounded on all sides if this amendment was to move forward. You know, the purpose of the amendment is obviously to add the property to the urban growth area, but part of that as well is the city can't legally annex property outside of our urban growth area, even if we own it. So this is primarily city-owned property that we're not able to legally annex because it's in the rural county. So the first step in getting this added to the city limits would be to add it first to the urban growth area. A little bit about the park itself. So this is 420 total acres owned by the city of Lacey. I think it's the largest municipal park in Thurston County. About 210 acres are located in rural Thurston County outside of the UGA. So again, about 210 acres that are located in rural Thurston County. There are some additional parcels, as I mentioned, that would also be proposed for inclusion in there, including the 7 single family residences that would be surrounded on all sides by urban growth area. So in our mind, it doesn't make a lot of sense to basically allow rural zoning kind of donut holes within the boundary of the Kuyo Park area. Out of those 7, 3 are actually bifurcated by the existing urban growth boundary. So I'll go back and look. If you look at under the additional parcels, there are 3 to the south of this kind of label here that actually are split. So the southern portion of those properties are actually located in this purple area, which is the Lacey urban growth area. The white area to the north is rural Thurston County. So they're actually split in half by the urban growth area. So makes a lot of sense just to add those as well. There are an additional 4 parcels that are at the end of Pleasant Glade Road that would be surrounded on all 4 sides by our city park. And our thought is to add those to the urban growth area versus keeping them as some kind of rural donut hole. So the total request that makes this up is about 220 acres. So that includes the 210 acres for the park and another 10 acres for those 7 single family residences. A little bit about Kuyo Park. The property was purchased in 2011 by the city. And we are moving forward with developing. We've approved a master plan for the property and moving forward with phase 1A of that project here soon, which include pedestrian trails, playground, a disc golf course, and a restroom. So just kind of minimal development initially. And the reason that kind of the idea for the minimal development was that most of the park itself was actually purchased to protect habitat, salmon habitat in particular, and also mitigate a water rights acquisition. So there is not all of the park can be used for active recreational uses. There is a considerable amount that basically needs to remain natural so that we can offset any impacts to water rights. It was purchased through a pot of money that was used to offset water rights authorization. So we have certain strings attached with what that property can be used for with the money that we bought it from. So I think we talked a little bit before about looking at the urban growth area amendment criteria, and Lacey staff believes that this proposal meets all of the criteria. First of all, it's going to be served by municipal water and sewer. So utility extensions are a part of the criteria, and this property, we're already you know, basically developing at least the southern portion to include water and sewer. And so, you know, that can be easily extended to the northern part for the what related to this proposal for the addition. Another criteria is that urbanization is compatible with use of designated resource lands in critical areas. The property itself is, as I mentioned, you know, it was purchased for the purpose of offsetting water rights mitigation for salmon habitat and those kinds of things. So certainly compatible with any resource lands and critical areas that are nearby. It's contiguous to not only the existing urban growth boundary, but it's contiguous to our municipal corporate limits. So no issues with that. And then this last criteria, which in the last proposal, it was a little different. You were looking at the criteria, which basically stated, you know, that UGAs can be expanded if there's not enough capacity to accommodate 20 years of population projections and those kinds of things. There's a second criteria in that basically says if there's an overriding public interest and public benefit, that can be used as the criteria. And staff feels like that's you know, appropriate here. You know, and the public interest and public benefit here is that it doesn't make a whole lot of sense from a jurisdictional boundary standpoint to have a portion of the property in rural Thurston County and a portion in Lacey city limits. So it eliminates jurisdictional boundary issues. It also eliminates potential conflicts with things like calls for emergency services and those kinds of things. If it's eventually annexed to the city, the idea is that it will be, you know, provide urban services, but then as well urban, you know, amenities and first responders. So, you know, things like our City of Lacey Police Department, Lacey Fire District 3 would serve this area. So, you know, as I mentioned, part of the original proposals, the disc golf course, which would be separated, you know, kind of by different portions would be in the city, and certain portions would be in rural Thurston County. So depending on what hole of the disc golf course that you're on depends on who the call for service will originate with. So again, it doesn't make a lot of sense. So we feel like the public interest and public benefit are going to be served well by the request. So with that, that's all I have for you right now. Oh, actually I don't. I have this last slide, which I just mentioned most of it, which is allow for a park owned and maintained. I don't know if you, which one slide you can see anymore.
We're seeing the one you're reading off of.
Okay, so it would allow for a park owned and maintained by Lacey to be within the city. It eliminates potential confusion of emergency response based on where the call originates within the park and would eliminate the need to permit a park under multiple jurisdictions. I guess I already said most of this, but you probably couldn't see it. So with that, happy to answer any questions that you have. And again, the request is to forward this with a recommendation on to the Board of County Commissioners with your recommendation.
And Ryan, if I could just add one thing on the mitigation credits for the water rights acquisition. Although Lacey purchased the property that provided mitigation for Olympia's water rights package, as well as the Elms. So is that as part of that regional application?
Questions for Ryan. Eileen, go ahead.
Thank you. So looking at the proposed with the islands and then looking at the park plan, what happens to those four additional parcels? Do those have homes on there already, or are they just empty land? What happens? Do you acquire those then? So because it looks like they're going to be in the disc golf area.
All seven of the single family lots are all developed as that. They're all single family residential. The city owns a number of parcels. The ones that are proposed for the disc golf course are all undeveloped. So we don't have any plans to purchase any other property in that area at this point. So like I mentioned, those that are already developed will be allowed to continue. They'll have the benefit of being surrounded on all sides by city park and not having to worry about, you know, future development plans or those kinds of things happening around them. So I think that they'll probably, you know, enjoy the benefits that the park will provide being in close proximity.
So the site plan the phase 1A site plan doesn't show where those homes are, or is that in that green shaded to light area just left of Carpenter Road? Is that where they are?
I'm not exactly sure what you might be looking at. Are you looking at the staff report or?
It was part of our packet. It's on page 2. And I guess it would be from you guys. Yes, from Grant Beck and you.
Yeah, so. Okay. Yep, I'll just share my screen so the rest of the committee can see. Hopefully I haven't had best luck with this today. Hopefully that people can see this. Okay, so what we're talking about in terms of the residences in proximity to the disc golf course. So the disc golf course is the area with the yellow lines that are trails, and the disc golf course is kind of in the middle of all that. The actual homes themselves, hopefully you can see my cursor, so the homes are there. To the north and west, and then also to the west okay. Over here. So these are the four homes that are at the end of Pleasant Glade Road. And then these are the three that are bifurcated by the UGA. So, only proposed for development, but those areas that are owned by the city at this point. But the northern portion of this, so this area here is located in rural Thurston County. So again, that's the area that, is proposed for development in terms of the park development that we're requesting being added to the urban growth area.
Thank you.
Sure.
Great. Other questions or comments on this one? Perhaps. So we often get the little template motion in our work. We don't have a template motion provided, but we do know that the language would involve forwarding a recommendation to the Board of County Commissioners regarding Lacey's request to amend the Lacey Urban Growth Boundary.
Move approval, John O'Callaghan.
Right. Is there a second?
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to recommend to the Board of County Commissioners approval of Lacey's request to amend the Lacey Urban Growth Boundary. Is there any other discussion? Right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. There we go.
Aye. Okay.
And any opposed? Nay. Okay, thank you for presenting, Ryan, and we'll make that recommendation to the Board of Commissioners.
Thank you.
All right. Our next item is about setting a time for the next meeting of the subcommittee. And because we've improvised a little bit across the agenda today, both about the tribal work that's coming sooner and the work related to our decision around the Grand Mound urban growth area, maybe Allison can give us a recommendation about a next meeting, whether holding on to that June 29th meeting or finding a different date makes more sense.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, we, in anticipation that there might be a need for further discussion on some of these items, and knowing how busy all of your schedules are, we had held a time on June 29th for a meeting, but based on the discussion I've heard today, I think on both of the two items, the committee has requested some additional information or review done before it comes back to you. My recommendation would be that we don't set a time at this meeting. We'll wait for both of those items to see what the appropriate time will be when it's ready to come back to the committee, and we'll reach out to you all to schedule a meeting at that time.
All right. Is that acceptable to everybody?
Agreed.
Awesome. Yep, sounds good.
And any good of the order after we've just reconvened this rusty, dusty old machine and got it up and running again? All right. Well, then I will thank you and thank staff for the preparation work. And we will meet again in a few months when there's more information And when there's an action taken about formally including the tribal representatives. With no further business before us, I will adjourn the Urban Growth Management Subcommittee of the Thurston Regional Planning Commission at 3:50 p.m.
Non-debatable motion. Y'all have a good day.
Thank you, and have a good evening.
Thank you.